I think Origins could push 80 hours easily. Oh dear God. Well, for crying out loud, how many hours did I get out of Dark Souls 1? 100 and... Oh my God. I got 254 hours out of Dark Souls. 254 hours. And I only got, I think, like halfway through NG++. Nope, stop it. Stop it.
They might have an interesting concept of what romance is. Eating your face, maybe.
Yeah, just dinner, right? That is romance to a dragon.
Take it easy, Keeler.
Moving on. So, how large is the landscape? The open world.
Yeah, I guess the no warp rule really tacked on some hours there, huh? Never I really experienced that game to like its fullest, I believe. Release on Origin? Oh, you don't think they're gonna come out? Oh, that's right, because they fought with the Steam, didn't they? Or is that The Witcher? I can't remember which one it was. What is my mic picking up? My mic is screwing up with me here.
Don't miss out on the year's ultimate gaming bundle, the Twitch E3 Digital Ticket. This collection of digital goods includes content from these renowned studios. You decide the price. Each purchase benefits the ESA Foundation and its mission to improve children's lives through video games. This week only, experience E3 like a pro.
Like a pro, because watching on Twitch is not pro, apparently. How was I just about to look up? I was about to look up something and it just completely slipped my mind. Crap. Coming up here next. Assassin's Creed Unity. Surprise! Haven't played any of the Assassin's Creed. Hot damn. I'm learning to code a game. Making my own game too. Really? You're gonna have to keep me updated on that. Have you already started working on it, or are you still like in the blueprint coming up with everything for it stage? Clearly we got a little bit of time here. Starts at what do we got? Oh, 6 minutes here. The next segment starts. Oh, there's man.
It's your boy Man here from Man vs. Game, of course, rocking my own brand at E3. What else are you going to do? And I'm joined by Justin Flynn. Not only Justin Flynn, but the Justin Flynn.
Yeah, the one and only. Not the saxophone player. Don't get me confused. That guy, he had the internet on lockdown for a long time. But
really?
I'm climbing the ranks.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm climbing the ranks.
That's it. Yeah, you got to do like the Google search, and then like, you know, once you edge him out.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay. Oh, and here we go. Okay. And we do have access to the chat here, but we are here basically what we're doing, we're filling time. That's what we're doing. But it is our first E3 here, and I want to tell you guys,
yeah.
It's absolutely insane.
It is absolutely insane, and I might absolutely be deaf after this. Are you incredibly, am I incredibly loud?
No, I think I got a lot of wax buildup in my ears, so this is good. This is
going to be an RPG. There you go.
Literally yelling at me, but that's okay, I love
it. Oh, are you doing like an RPG Maker game?
No, I can't hear a thing. Okay, we don't need to hear each other, but yeah, no, I am really, really stoked. I've been running around right here off stage. You actually can't see this, but Nerdist is here, and I'm really excited about that. There is a Lego Chris Hardwick that I took about a million selfies with.
Yeah, like, everywhere you look, it's just hype everything. Like you said, the Nerdist over here, their booth they have, like a perfect replica of the dog's helm.
Yeah,
it's Sander Clegane, if you know.
Stormtrooper, it's like everything. They got all the gear over there. Don't come hang out with us. Go hang out with them. It's really cool.
That's what it is. And I
there you go.
By the way, and I do lift. For anybody that was wondering, I do practice the sport parts.
Yeah, actually, I saw you. You got up early, right? You were doing push-ups and hit the gym and came back to the room. That
like
was
every
intense.
Morning. Every morning. Just like that. I'm dirty bulking right now, but so you know.
Yeah, you got a dirty bulk. Well, I was doing a dirty bulk through winter, and I kind of extended that into a summer, and I think I'm just going to take it back around one more.
Which was
yeah. I just kind of like.
Do you have an idea of which one you might use when you're preferring leaning towards?
Yeah, we do have access to the chat here. What dost thou even hoist? Guys, thank you so very much for watching today. Day one. I don't know if you guys saw day zero, those press conferences, the announcements. Just insane. Sony, of course, it was like the press conference that kept on giving.
Yeah.
There was just one game, just one letdown.
Oh. I don't even know if you don't say it, man.
I know.
Don't
we probably wouldn't even be talking about it if the whole, you know, debacle wouldn't have happened before the event here. But I have not really had much of a chance to walk around the showroom floor. Have you gotten a chance to see any of the craziness?
Well, I kind of might have walked around. I might have walked around a little bit into some areas I wasn't supposed to. Already got kicked out of the show twice today early. We got in super early, right? We were in here at like 8 a.m., right?
Yeah.
So everyone's just putting stuff together. All the games are up, and I'm just like, oh my God, you know?
Yeah.
Freaking out. And so I ran over, of course, to Sony. They said, get out of here. And then and I turned the corner, and then a huge just open. See, the Sony's kind of got to like get in through a kind of like a little door thing and stuff. But it's huge. They got a huge area. But then I went over to Nintendo, and they're kind of open. It seemed really
Cry Engine. Okay.
Like Hyrule Warriors, Pokemon. Like I was just hitting it all hard, and someone walked up to me and was like, "So are you with Nintendo?" And of course I said, "Yeah, man. I wouldn't be here if I wasn't." Fully checked the bag, kicked me out. So I apologize, Nintendo.
You lied to Nintendo?
I lied.
You're going to get us kicked out of our first E3.
I know. I lied. So anyway, they blue-shelled me straight out of there.
Oh, nice.
Gone.
Nice. Even though you had the Nintendo lanyard.
Yes.
Which I think that's the official.
Yeah,
like,
I had the
license.
Lanyard. Come on, guys. I tried to pull it off. Oh, of course. Of course I'm with them.
Yeah. So, like, I'm trying to think of, like, what we're looking forward to today. I guess, like, later on the cast, I am going to be hosting the segment where we're going to be talking about Tom Clancy's The Division. Yeah. That one.
Nice.
So definitely
yeah.
hyped about that.
Dude, that
game
was crazy.
Looks
the trailer,
yeah,
was nuts. Everyone silent. Everyone was silent.
Sure. Yeah. Can we take a look at the schedule? Just what we're going to be going over today. Coming up next, we are going to be going taking a look at Assassin's Creed Unity.
Oh, that schedule though.
The multiplayer going on in that.
I know. I do actually have a Black Flag Assassin's Creed, but I've been debating. Does it make a lot of noise right there? If I should hold off on playing Black Flag, if it's really necessary to play the entire Assassin's Creed series. But I've heard that, like, a couple of them are just so long and so hard to get into. So hard to get into. Welcome back, Matthias.
I think before we get into the next segment, you were crazy hyped in the back for Bayonetta 2.
Oh, like, oh, the Nintendo, yes, the digital live event this morning, some big reveals, the character from Kid Icarus, she's in there.
I really was hoping for a Star Fox game.
The princess.
The princess. Is that, okay, yes. Yeah.
And Twitch lags.
Well, anyway, yeah, Smash is going to be really sick, but the figure thing is actually interesting. I feel like I just seriously lost a lot of money in about 10 seconds.
The Amiibo, yeah, absolutely. Which
Assassin's Creed 2. What was it? Was it the third one? I heard it was like, Keeler was describing it to me. And he said there's a part where you are more or less like on a little boat, like an hour, trying to get somewhere or something like that.
Seeing
like Sega, nods to Sega, all the little Easter eggs, stuff. And so it was very cool seeing all the Nintendo stuff.
It was empty and useless. Well, there's a review for you right there by Matthias. Man, you know what? I haven't even updated my news down below. I need to update that. Today is just like a blah. We're here. We're all chilling, watching the E3. We all have our comments, and you get to see me kind of slowly update everything here. I don't know. I'm a fan of pirates. You know, the whole naval aspect, maybe that plays into it. I love naval stuff. Okay, here we go. You guys have really upped the ante with the tech. It's fantastic. What kind of I know you guys partnered up with Nvidia for the PC version, so it's just going to be pumped crazy for the PC version, which is awesome. I'm a PC guy myself, so
I'm excited for it on PC.
Yeah, we're very excited ourselves with the what we can do with the hardware. It's just crazy. I mean, we just you can see here the size of the urban setting is just massive.
It's
beautiful.
We
can have
when is the next Deadly Premonition cast? Might pick back up on the game later today, actually. Well, actually, as far as the backstory goes, I'm pretty sure I know what it is. It's you are this guy, and they place you in this machine which lets you go back and live what like your ancestors did. Apparently, you know, the guy's ancestor is an assassin, so you go through that. I don't know if that plays any role on if the guy is trying to do something in the present time or anything, or if it's just some new technology they're testing out. Third kill the license. Yeah, I've heard the third was just not happening at all. That's the American Revolution one, right? Yeah, you know what? I was watching a friend of mine play that one. And he was at this part where you are playing as a I don't know what tribe it was, Apache or whatever, but you're playing as a kid, and you're supposed to climb trees, hunt things, find poop, And it was just going on and on and on and on and on. I was like, what is the purpose of all this?
Yeah, I can't believe how gorgeous it is. You guys have really upped it just since Black Flag. It's kind of shocking.
So here we can see our new stealth mode on a touch of a button. He leans down, he crouches. We have a contextual crouching mechanism. And when we do that, detection from the enemies is narrow. You're more silent. So it's something else that our fans wanted to see.
Excellent.
In Assassin's Creed.
The textures are gorgeous. Wow.
All the interiors are seamless. 1 out of 4 buildings in Paris will be accessible.
That's
there's stuff
crazy.
To find. There's loot, treasure chest. I mean, there's just, again, it's just for people that are...
1 out of 4 buildings accessible. That's not bad.
And in terms of the co-op...
That's one thing I've always kind of... found disappointing in games. That's I don't want to say open world in a city. A lot of the buildings, it just you can't access them.
This is right here is one of your friends. He's online.
Okay, great.
So, you know, we've contextualized. Well,
yeah, clearly at this point, I think it's pretty safe to assume you are not the same assassin just because of all the jumps in the timeline.
It almost smells like 1790s Paris. It looks so guttural and visceral and real. It's fantastic.
I enjoyed all Assassin's Creeds except for the third one. Okay, so yeah, apparently everyone is agreeing the third is just terrible. Well, I don't want to use the word terrible, just doesn't fit. We'll say that it doesn't fit. I will, God, as I was watching it this morning, because again, I couldn't watch it last night because I had to get some sleep before work. Sony's conference. So much talking. So much talking. I can't remember his name right now, but the CEO, I was literally falling asleep. He was putting me to sleep. I couldn't stand it.
Besides just the co-op aspect, do you guys are still bringing back the multiplayer of each other and, you know, the actual... battle modes and whatnot with people, right? It's not just co-op.
We're not bringing the PvP mode for
no
for
PvP.
No, not
okay.
this year. You'll have to wait it out.
Oh, we're gonna have to wait. But you know what? Who cares? Because the co-op looks amazing. I remember playing 3, and wishing that I could just bring in my brother or a friend and play with them. So this is kind of a little Assassin's Creed
yep.
dream come true.
Yeah,
that's fantastic. So can you maybe tell us what exactly you're doing day to day? Whenever it comes to the game.
So what we got kind of up here?
Job behind this. You're pretty important.
I did Xbox unannounced title. Killer Instinct Season 2.
Montreal is leading the development. We have 400 people back home, and then we have 400 more across the world that are working on different parts of the game. They each have their own talents, their own way of making things, and I basically have to make.
Seems strange to me. It just means that you get to have more fun killing. All of it.
Inspiration behind wanting to have the next game in the French Revolution. I think it's a great setting. I think it's fantastic and makes sense. But what made you guys say that 1790s? That's perfect.
It was in our bucket list. It was
you
have all these cool pivotal moments of
sure.
history, and we know that they make a great setting for our franchise. So it was there. We wanted to make it right and wait until we had the tech to do it. We knew that the French Revolution features had massive crowds of people rioting
sure.
and all the chaos and everything. So we knew we needed to do that.
All right, so I'm gonna take another quick little break here.
You guys have several more amazing aspects of history.
I will be back in a few minutes. And we'll see what this next segment's gonna be.
miss out on the year's ultimate gaming bundle, the Twitch E3 Digital Ticket. This collection of digital goods includes content from these renowned studios. You decide the price. Each purchase benefits the ESA Foundation and its mission to improve children's lives through video games. This week only, experience E3 like a pro with a Twitch E3 Digital Ticket.
All right, I'm back. Don't look like I've missed anything. That Mario Maker game, man. Find it actually pretty funny. I may have to start looking into the, we'll see if the Assassin's Creed's go on sale, theme for the summer. I have to keep my eyes glued to see him like a freaking hawk. I know last year there was like a ton of stuff I wanted to buy, but I had like no money the entire week. So this time it should be a little bit different. What are we waiting on here? They should be starting, actually. It is 11:20 now. Oh, wait a minute. Long term time frame. No, I'm not. 11:20, according. There it is. Okay. Yeah, if I remember correctly, all I had for this was a CGI trailer as well. No gameplay. Another title I'm going to have to get is The Last of Us. I never played that. Shocking. Flamethrower.
Day one of E3 Live, powered by Twitch. I, of course, am Man for Man versus Game here, joining you. I am joined by Ryan from Massive. We are here talking about Tom Clancy.
Well, let's hope we get some gameplay.
That trailer, I just want to say, seriously, one of the most powerful trailers that I've seen, definitely yesterday during the press conferences.
Thank you. We're really, really proud of it. It's it gets me every time. I cry a little bit.
It is, seriously, the feels, right, guys? Like, powerful stuff, like just a chilling idea. Basically, what you could see there is like the breakdown of society.
Yeah, I mean the idea with the trailer is to kind of get get people into the universe. So we kind of follow the story of a family as we go down when the disease hits, and you see what happens and the results of that, and then as it moves out into the city, and then the introduction of who you'll be playing in the game, which is the Division itself, and getting across that relatable story of, you know, what if this situation, you know, could have happened. And you know, our creative team working with Blur was we're really, really proud of the results we got, because it's a different kind of trailer, I would say.
Yeah.
Than you see. It's not about big explosions. It's more about kind of exploring.
The release. At this point, yeah, we never get any fucking gameplay for a lot of these games.
I love the time lapse. I love also basically how, like, you don't see anybody. You kind of see, like, the effects of what's going on while the plague kind of
yes.
ravages New York. Tragedy. Yeah, yeah, exactly, and just powerful stuff. So, I mean, basically, we're getting into the story, but do you want to kind of go into a little bit, a general overview of what the Division is kind of about?
Sure. So, I mean, the game itself, we're an open-world RPG in the Clancy universe that's set in New York City, obviously, where a virus has been released on Black Friday, which is the biggest shopping day in the U.S.
Right.
And it basically kills a vast majority of the population, and the, you know, the infrastructure of the city starts to break down. You know, lawlessness kind of spreads throughout the city, and Directive 51 is activated.
For all these games that they show no gameplay,
so they're number one kind of
nowhere near ready.
I really should have like a glass pane around me, like just quarantine me off. But yeah, truly chilling stuff. And you're talking about the Division, like the actual, because you're not like a rogue, you know, sort of, you know, vigilante. You are actually, you know, empowered by, you know, the president.
Absolutely.
What
so
I was reading.
Yeah, the lore behind the creating a new Clancy unit in the, I guess, the spectrum of games is we wanted to. You know, find a place where, you know, the Rainbow games, you know, those units have a purpose, the Splinter Cell, the, you know, where can we make a unit that makes sense? So having a homeland base Clancy unit that responds to catastrophic events.
God, the chat in this channel is fucking amazing.
You know, with where we're at in this day and age, kind of the scariest phenomenon to think about is
really get to see all the fucking toxic loom around Twitch.
Good hunters and gatherers anymore. So when things break down and yeah, exactly. I'm
look at me. It's like, do you think if you put me out in the middle of a forest, like I would survive like 15 minutes? Top.
Exactly. I would be one of the first people dead in the scenario of our game as well. So that was really interesting for us to try to create a Clancy unit that you know, that you would that would fit in this scenario. And then to wrap that with, you know, an online RPG. So there's progression, there's character empowerment, there's, you know, all the things that people that play these types of games are looking for.
Yeah. And it, just it sounds amazing. Like you're saying, with like the open world aspect of New York, sort of like the ravaged New York, and you're just trying to take it back. So why don't we take a look at some of the gameplay, some of the multiplayer
sure,
aspects?
Sure. Absolutely.
Of it. Awesome.
Wow, actual gameplay, okay.
If you're watching on Twitch.
Yes, please usher your children from the room. Oh, there it goes. Tom Clancy. Always powerful.
Yes, powered by Snowdrop.
Coming on down. Am I looking at in-engine here?
Oh yeah, this is all, this is all in-engine. So we really wanted to bring it. You last year we were in Brooklyn, so this year we've come across. I don't know if people remember the Dude Checkout Manhattan line that got some fame, and now we're checking out Manhattan. So we came across and joined our group from last year, which further along in their progression.
Oh shoot! You know what? Wow, I do remember this. I do.
Sweet.
Yeah, we did see gameplay for this. 24K Gold Ring, how are you doing? Good to see you again. Yeah, I caught the very beginning of this gameplay though, so I didn't get to see too much, but it's probably, I guess. The Division.
Anytime the sort of like holograms like come up over everything.
Our UI team is, I don't know, from another planet. They're the Swedes. They know how to make stuff.
That they do. Jumping over.
Here we see a bunch of dead bodies.
Out of the subway. And there's Bronson.
Yeah.
Jump the turnstile. It's law, buddy. Some people, yeah, I know. That's scripted voice acting.
I saw he just tossed out the drone there.
Yeah, well, he tossed out a grenade, so we slid through it. And you're gonna, this is the drone just hovering up here. He's going to mark that target for us. We're going to show off some more snowdrop here by shooting some paint buckets. Tobias loves that part, our realization director. And then this is the revive mechanic. So you, when you're down in the game, you do have a chance to, you know, pick a buddy up to keep going in the fight before you bleed out.
Revive him.
Yes.
You stand up, you take 10 steps, get back in that fight.
And we threw out a sentry or a turret skill here to take aggro from the last two guys here, while we revived the other player, and now we've got the elite with a big ass gun here as the last enemy. So we're gonna.
This guy's nuts. Do something about him.
With a cluster seeker mine, which is a modified seeker mine from last year that we showed, and then of course it's an RPG, so we get a nice legendary loot drop here at the end just to kind of tease you.
Which is so cool, yeah, like the loot system. It just sounds incredible, like going through the open world, you know, joining up with buddies, just clearing out enemies and grabbing that loot.
And taking back New York.
That's right. That's right. It looks absolutely stunning. I will absolutely be down playing some of this, I know for sure.
Good.
So
hopefully everybody will.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, freaking Watch Dogs, I never saw that game. I was like, I have to play this. It was completely I saw it and I was like, I am perfectly fine never playing this. It just never, I don't know, something about never caught me.
Sure, yeah, and what I always like to say is, like, you know, don't rush it, you know, just make sure.
Exactly, I think everybody would rather have the game right.
Totally, yes, you want to get it out there, you know, because the rush game, it's...
The hype, though, for it, my God. Oh, the hype for Watch.
I mean, we don't talk about numbers, but when you think about weapons in the game, think of them more as almost like archetypes. So all weapons have kind of a damage spread. They have an optimal use range. So the categories of weapons we have, which are pistols, SMGs, assault rifles, sniper rifles, and shotguns, they usually match with the skill loadout. So you want to, if you have a close range weapon that's high damage, you want to match that with skills that are going to supplement that playstyle. Number of weapons, how many will end up? It's a lot. It's a Clancy game.
Yeah.
Our weapons are being made by the very talented team at Red Storm in North Carolina. So we got Merkins making our guns. So
Merkins.
You got all those Merkins on your guns.
Yeah.
Oh my.
There will be a lot, but we'll come out with the exact number. But think of it more of the categories. And then within those categories, you'll be able to modify your weapons with scopes, silencers, and kind of increase the potency.
Did you play it at all, Matthias?
Playstyle that you're looking for.
Cool. And like you said, you know, like they got like a legendary drop from that enemy.
Yes.
And so that's where like you're looking for like just like the highest caliber.
Yeah, we'll have quality ranges in the game. So it's, I think a great RPG mechanic in games to kind of drive you to want to find better quality gear. Especially in our setting, in our IP, where everything is important, everything matters. And then you have qualities that are, you know, from common to up to legendary, basically, in the game. And they'll just have better stats, they'll have more modification slots, and you'll want to, eventually, they'll be customized for player versus player in the game. So it's definitely a big part of the Clancy experience. We are a very, very loot-focused and character empowerment-driven game.
Sweet, yeah. And in the open-world environment, that's exactly what you want.
Yeah.
Do you know, like, in terms of for the open map?
Come on, man, give it a chance. You can hack stoplights. Can't go wrong with hacking stoplights.
You need to think about it like it's not a. I saw some comments on the stream earlier that, you know, it's like, is it an MMO? Is it not an MMO? I don't like using the term. I've worked on MMOs forever. That's kind of my bread and butter. We don't consider The Division a conventional MMO.
Right.
I think there's a lot of baggage that comes with that. So what
totally.
We do is when you and I are playing, we're in our own copy of the universe, our own phase, if you will.
Right.
There are public spaces where we can see other players that'll have X number of players allowed in those slots, one of them being player versus player areas, and then there's also a hub, a common area, the kind of the last foothold in Manhattan where you'll see other players. But when you're out in the open world, it's your instance of the world. So
okay.
You won't see random people doing your missions, running across in different areas. So it's a more private, tailored experience when you're out in the open world.
Cool. So you're not going to be like waiting for like the respawn
exactly.
of the guy in
exactly.
the area.
I mean, I think that's a little bit of a dated type of mechanic. So we want to get the best of both worlds for the game.
Right. Which I think is smart. Because like you said, the term MMO, once you say that, people like...
Yeah, there's a lot of baggage.
Yes. Like I know some people, you know, get kind of... used to get hyped like, oh, MMO, and now it's just like, oh, I don't know, I've been there, kind of done that.
Yeah.
Very cool. In terms of platforms, what can we...
We are coming out on all three big platforms, so we'll be on PS4, Xbox One, and PC.
Sweet. I'll probably go PS4, even though, I don't know, this could be one that could, like...
The game will be excellent on all platforms.
Yeah, I know, that's right. And it's, of course, there's the PC master race out there pushing. It's going to be pushing the graphical limits of everything. Absolutely incredible. I loved hearing that there's a PvP area.
Yes.
Which, because that could be, like, a whole community will, you know, grow around that. Because I know for, you know, I do still play some MMOs.
Mm-hmm.
And the PvP is probably one of the more enjoyable aspects of it.
Absolutely, and we want to make it part of the core experience for the game. So not everybody likes PvP, so you won't have to in the game, but we really hope, just like playing with others, that you'll experience, you'll see how it's different and how we handle it in the game, and kind of hopefully get hooked into that kind of gameplay loop.
Sweet. Well, Ryan, the game looks absolutely incredible.
Thank you.
Love the idea. I can't wait to get my hands on it. Thank you so very much for joining me, and thanks for watching, guys. I think we're going to take a quick break and then move it along to the next segment. Thanks so much for watching,
guys. Thanks, guys.
We'll be right back.
That was informative. That's Harley. Upper list. We have another oh. There it is. Okay. Just because of the villain here, this looks pretty good. I want to see more of him. He just seems like an awesome villain. Oh, I saw it, buddy. I have to get an X. I'm just gonna have to get all fucking platforms. Oh my god.
Do those words sound the same?
That it got out of control?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. What'd you say?
It got out of control.
Got out of control.
Shank!
I hate when things get out of control. One fucking job, but you couldn't fucking do that!
You had one fucking job, buddy! One fucking job. I like the Fable Legend Online concept. I want to see single player. I will completely agree with you on. Completely agree with you.
At least there's a silver lining. You didn't completely fuck it up. Get up, boy. I recognize those eyes anywhere. I'm so sorry about this. This was supposed to be. Well, not this. We have a party waiting for you. I don't think I know your name. Who is this? Hmm? Is this your plus one? Strong silent type. I like it. I am terribly embarrassed about all of this. This was supposed to be very simple, but you know, if you give food to monkeys, they just throw their shit at each other. You know? Oh, would you hold this? For just a moment, I want to get a little picture.
Baja.
Don't worry about a thing, my boy. This is
soon. I believe Baja. Panty89. Thank you very much for the follow and the support. Welcome to the community here on. Allow me to give you a mark. But yet, let's shine it up a bit here.
To the limited edition. Includes three extra story missions.
No, I haven't played any Far Cries. What platforms do I have at the moment? At the moment, just pretty much PC. And then the newest thing I have is a 360.
How can you not love that trailer? That guy is a psychopath.
Yeah, I've seen it a million times, but it's great.
So you guys have put a lot of...
Oh, yeah, I have some upgrading to do. I have a lot of upgrading to do. I was looking forward to building a casting computer. And just run this current computer through a capture card through the casting computer. But it looks like I'm tossing all that money into some console. Yeah, the exclusive content. so much exclusiveness from this E3. I do actually have, what is it? Far Cry, why can I not freaking remember? Yeah, Blood Dragon. Yeah, I got the PS2. Holy shit. We're gonna put your pants back on. But, yeah, I have Blood Dragon, which actually, I got Blood Dragon and, Black Flag when I ordered the, AMD processor, current machine. So I have those. I just never play them yet. Improved glances. Is he doing it that often? Let's see. God, hold on. The screen is pissing me off. Now this new freaking lighting, man. Killing me.
And then the music plays.
Do
like
it.
They're gonna go like gun or
yeah,
something.
It's crazy. But I mean, it's all about exploring the living world, right? We know that we built the anecdote factory in Far Cry 3, and then with Far Cry 4, we want to be able to explore it, and we want to be able to make sure that it is bigger, that you're able to do things that you couldn't do before, and that everywhere you can see, you can go. That was our goal.
Yeah. As far as the as far as the new Fable. It does completely come off as an entirely new game. Like it doesn't, personally to me, I don't see it as Fable anymore. It's all, it's always been the same thing. Single player, here's the story, go. But this is an entirely new concept. Her personally, as I've discussed before, the Fable series itself did for me was kind of dying. 3 was in some areas was a slap in the face.
So what was the biggest change for you guys in what you thought you were going to be doing and then what you decided you were going to do after that visit?
I think, you know, when you think about something at 12...
No Man's Land. Yeah, I was about to say. I mean, yeah, No Man's Sky, that looks pretty interesting. Although, I really think he was overhyping it the hell up with the whole infinite... No two players experience will be the same, everything like that. That overhype.
And as far as the people we're gonna see in this game, I mean, you almost don't want to be.
I just honestly cannot see how you can have an MMO that those two people will either start off or, you know, experience the same kind of thing to a degree. May not be like the exact same to a T, but.
And so you're going to be able to go there, you're going to be able to discover it. And the theme of the game in some places is what's sacred is under attack. When you're making a bad guy, you got to make him bad, right? Pagan Min shows up. He basically looks at this world and he says, I'm going to drag you guys into the 21st century. And everybody goes, you know what? We're fine where we are. And he goes, listen to me. He puts his face on the money. And he says, nobody says no to me. Nobody. And then he puts on a pink suit and he goes, go ahead, talk about it. I dare you. And everybody goes, okay, easy, calm down, big fella. Take it easy.
I will say this. The whole open, we'll say universe thing. You leave one planet, just go straight to another seamlessly. That was that. And if it is infinite, as they claim it is, that's pretty interesting. It really was a smooth transaction of planet to another. Hop in and go. Personally, I mean, I know they showed some combat. I hope there is more actual space combat, though. Whole free flight, flying into a fleet of starships. That would be pretty badass in my book. Red Dead Redemption, that was good. I enjoyed that thoroughly. Can't say too much for the ending, but it made sense.
Can you tell me a little bit more about the co-op mode that you played?
Yeah, it's cool. So, at the end of Far Cry 3, we had this character named Herc. Mm-hmm. And so we're bringing Herc back. And the goal is really, really simple from the standpoint of, if you're playing your single-player adventure, right, and you're going through that, you're meeting Pagan Min, you're meeting some of the other characters that I can't talk about, but I desperately want to talk about. what you gonna
That's another thing I'm looking forward to, Last of Us. Yeah, I'm right there with you. I never played it.
You got your game safe, everything that you're doing, your profile is set, all the stuff for progression is great, and then you're able to go and basically play in the open world, do whatever you want. And you saw Herc shows up, you guys take over an outpost. The goal for us was, we wanted the idea that if you decided that you wanted to have you and your buddy with music in the background, wings suiting through the Himalayas, you could totally do it, and you could take over an outpost, and we could give you that dream and basically realize it.
So the co-op is not just about completing objectives. It's also about just throwing like a wild party in Kirat.
Sometimes, you know what? You want to just go out into the open world and you want to just play. You just want to have fun. And we don't want to sequester it. We don't want to make rules about it. If you decide you want to go out and you want to sit on top of elephants and you want to go out and hunt something, go do that. If you want to go, you want to grapple up to the top and you want to basically wingsuit off with your buddy and you guys are going to have challenges or whatever else, go do that. If you decide that you want to go blow up turtles or whatever else, go do that. It's your game. Play it your way.
Blow up turtles?
Yeah, that's what people love
blow
to do.
Blow up turtles?
In Far Cry 3, I remember seeing guys who would sit there and they'd blow up turtles. They do it over and over again. If that's the kind of thing you want to do, you can do it.
Hey man, they gotta get that money somehow. They gotta have you buy it now. Hype it the hell up.
As soon as this game was announced, I fixated. I don't know why.
Yeah.
On the elephant. What can I do? How many elephants can I have? Can I stack them? Can
I
breed them? Are they like chocobos? Is this a mini game?
Here's the thing: is that the one thing that we wanted to make sure of was that there's something majestic and regal about an elephant. So a lot of the other animals that you can go through and kill in the game, you can skin elephants. We're not going to do that. you get on top of the elephant and you're going to realize this is a majestic animal and it has the ability to basically, it's a very unique
majestic elephant
to a very specific lock. When you walk up to a fortress and you see the size of this thing, you realize, my God, this thing's huge. How am I going to get inside? Maybe I can grapple around. Maybe I can climb around the side. Maybe I can sneak in. Or I can knock on the front door with my elephant. And the knock is very loud and very persuasive.
Very persuasive.
Very persuasive.
Well, what I appreciate what you've done here is, you know, we usually see there's human characters in the game and then there's everything else, and it's part of the background. And so you're really trying to make every part of Far Cry alive. That's something I noticed in all the games, and especially in this one. Everything seems so alive as you're walking through it. What kind of work goes on in the studio to kind of make this?
Yeah, I've only pre-ordered a few titles. The last one was Dark Souls 2. Before that, I pre-ordered. I know there's something else I've maybe it's only been two titles.
And that there are groups of people that live in the game that are indigenous to the environment that live in the game that know each other, that understand each other. So you can sit back and effectively watch that. It has to be alive. If it's not alive, you're not going to believe it as a player.
Absolutely. The other thing I noticed was that, you know, the weapons, we have weaponized elephants. We have
Destiny.
Of third world, first world weapons. What is our range here?
It's a wide
Destiny.
When we talk about some of the things that we wanted to be able to do, the hardest thing is a death.
Looking forward to that.
And it's sometimes a little heartbreaking is that you get to the end of a game cycle, or you get to the end of a game, and you want to get something in, and you can't quite get it in, and you're like, oh, God, that feature has to go in. And so when we think about some of the things we wanted to be able to do, we wanted to be able to make it so that you could shoot from vehicles. We wanted to be able to make sure that you could do a takedown from a vehicle, and you saw it in the demo where you're driving alongside the truck, you're in the tuk-tuk, and there's two guys there, and you think, oh, what am I going to do? You lean in, you open the door, you take the guy out, you kill the other guy.
As far as the DLC for Dark Souls 2, I'm debating on if I want to play them as they come out, or just wait for when the last one is released, and then just go through them all.
Not wrong, right? I
and
mean, he destroys the convoy. He's wingsuiting. He's flying down, and all of a sudden, there's another objective, and the game just sort of you follow your nose.
Absolutely. So, what else am I missing here?
What else are you missing? Well, there's a lot of stuff I can't talk about. There's a lot of stuff I do want to talk about. But I think, you know, for me, when we're building Far Cry 4, the idea that you can go out into the living world and you can just play with a friend. I mean, it's pretty amazing when you sort of look at increasing the fractal of fun. You call a buddy. They come in. You say, hey, look, I'm really struggling with this outpost. What do you think? Can you come in? Can you give me a hand? Okay, how do you want to take it? We can do it stealth. We can do a grapple. We can get in the gyrocopter. We can get on top of an elephant. How do you want to do it?
Can we selfie, too?
Do we totally?
Is that an option in the game? I mean, he selfies. I should be able to selfie.
You know, I don't even know if we can do that, but we should be able to do that. We totally should. We should be able to do that.
Call me next time.
All right. Before we get to E3,
yeah,
we'll call
before
you.
I do love that.
We need
the elephant copter.
I get it.
We
need
the
elephant their server crashed. Because everyone flooded it all at once.
Yeah, November 18th. For sure. Yeah. Everybody, the team has a ton of stuff to offer. They're just dying to show everybody, and this is our first.
Actually, hold on. When was, maybe Destiny's one of.
It's going to be huge.
I cannot wait. Well, thank you so much,
cool.
Dan.
Thank
the
you
game
very much.
Looks amazing,
cheers.
And I know everyone is excited to see it. So
awesome.
Thank you guys so much.
I believe that was next. Oh, that was September.
Out on the year's ultimate gaming bundle, the Twitch E3 digital ticket. This collection of digital goods includes content from these renowned studios. You decide the price. Each purchase benefits the ESA Foundation and its mission to improve children's lives through video games. This week only, experience E3 like a pro with a Twitch E3 digital ticket.
Okay. Yeah, I mean their servers crash in what? Seconds. Then they said, it's live now. Dead. Yay, Call of Duty. But yeah, I guess yeah, Battlefield wanted a slice of that Payday 2 pie.
Oh yeah, it's taking a real beating. They're a little off track here. They're being dropped from about 70,000 feet up.
And we almost got a man overboard.
Yeah,
now.
This yep. Moment's intense. Yeah. This is hanging on.
Yeah, pretty exciting, really. Yeah. This is 3 years of development on next gen, right? And you can see here.
I like Tom Cruise.
That when you're watching this.
Absolutely.
So
yep. Same thing with the special effects and everything else, just layers put on top.
Is your first moment with the EXO and the strength of the EXO?
So he's wearing this EXO suit right now.
Yes, yeah. That's how he's able to kick this open.
Oh man, EXO suits.
And the early first generation of the EXO. So you can imagine as this story progresses, all of the technology that is going to advance over 10 years and what that means for your EXO and where it goes.
So you're starting off with this basic EXO suit, and as the game progresses, you're just getting like next level, like that's really cool.
And plus,
so
you're going to be able to upgrade it at the end of each level. You can, put points into it. Do I want to be faster? I want to have a be stronger, faster reload, that sort of thing.
Do your points, the points you get, depend on how well you're doing the level, or
yep.
Whether you complete objectives?
Yes. Yep.
So it's just further into like motivation to complete like side quests and that sort of thing.
Yeah, it really depends on how well you're doing the level. And
right.
And we can upgrade from there. And it's a little mini skill tree, so you don't. You're not going to get it all in the first playthrough.
Right. Does it carry on in the second playthrough? Like,
yep.
Is it? Oh, really? So it's like
yeah.
A new game plus, and you're just taking all your skill points, and you can just really just, like,
yeah,
layer that.
If you want to accumulate all of it.
Call of Duty.
And that's never been done in a Call of Duty game before, right?
No, this is a new thing, yeah.
That's awesome.
Yep.
Here's your sort of second EXO ability, and this is sort of boost assist or hovering. So the first time to really attack a vertical space. Pretty cool for Call of Duty.
Right. Can you tell me about the gun he's using right now?
Yeah, this is the HMR. This is a pretty exciting gun. It actually uses sort of 3D printing technology. We know that's happening to create its own ammo, right? And there's a bunch of science behind it that I won't try to explain here, but this is where things are going. And so this weapon, it creates its own ammo.
Very sweet. So that's like the regen we kind of see going on once you've expanded your rounds. Very
you
cool.
See the other pods dropping down.
This is what we call the AST.
Wow, is there like, there's a man in that suit right now, right?
Yes, that's
a,
yes.
And is that just a higher level exosuit, or?
Yeah, it's an armored security troop.
Whoa.
And yeah, it's really advanced that in that way. Here's a forward operating base where we're trying to get instructions.
So these guys are not so lucky, right? They don't have like the advanced exosuits, or is what we're wearing like that?
That's the exosuit.
So that's what we're wearing right now. Okay, cool.
And now you're gonna get to see another really great moment for us, where you know, more tech in terms of big vehicles like the tank coming up, and really the first game changer scene here, where you use boost jump to attack a battlefield.
Yeah. So let's see this in action.
Love this moment.
Yeah, and the audio on this is insane.
Now, what is this beast that's like coming down over here?
It's just a walking tank. And you know, it's able to get around a lot better, like here, than the normal tanks. Which we saw a normal tank before,
right?
But even that is huge.
It's just menacing, knowing that at least it's on our side, at least this part of the game, right?
For now.
For now.
Yeah.
And you know, that's based off of research too. And we saw a working prototype of that at NASA, believe it or not.
Yeah, those Mortal Kombat fatalities.
That must have been a fun part of the process, right? Going over there, seeing all this new tech, doing this research. This is over 3 years.
A lot of research, a lot of.
Was there any stuff you just weren't allowed, that you were allowed to see but couldn't really implement or talk about? I mean, how much, like, you know, blacked out stuff did you not even, like, well, I guess, you know.
Not sure. I mean, we found, we went pretty deep on research and.
So what are these things? That, like, these are drones?
These are drones.
Drone
and
swarm.
Yeah, and they're like, you know, fish. A school of fish. That's how it, one moves and they all follow it. But they're pretty powerful.
So these
are
like.
Attack you.
And when they do attack you, what can you expect? They kind of like
here's a new mechanic where you can grab the door off a car and use that as a shield.
I love how the glass is just like shattering as you're holding it.
Yeah.
And that's a really great example of using throughout the level. So if you see a car door open, rip it off, use it as a shield. Players can do that wherever they want.
And you would be able to do that with that exosuit. So this is all like opens up all these new possibilities. So what's going on? So where are we now?
We're just a little bit later in the level. It's a really big level, so we want to move a little forward. This is a mobile platform. This is what it is. It's shooting you guys.
Right.
It's just taking people out, but then it's able to fly away really quickly. And now that we've got our eyes on this one, we need to take it out. Sure. They're really dangerous.
I've seen a couple other things in here, like the Exo Dodge. That's that fast move right and left.
Right.
New to Call of Duty. The Threat Grenade and Threat Detection, which you see here on the mobile turret platform, allows you to pull your enemies sort of visually out of the
See how you go into ADS and it pops the.
Yes. How far can that laser go? Is there like a distance limit on that? That's
It has a limit, but man, is that thing powerful?
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to use that.
So in previous,
that's actually we call that a new class of weapons for the game called directed energy, right? Or weaponized energy.
Weaponized energy. Yeah. Very. And is there like a wide selection of them throughout the game?
Yeah, there's a number you're gonna be able to pick, and you can imagine what that
should
means.
Should have the grenade.
Class.
Smart grenade.
So now, previous Call of Duty games had like sliding and dolphin dives. Like, is there going to be like a version of that in Advanced Warfare?
Yeah, we call this the first really significant redesign of the movement set. So from boost, jump, slam.
And so coming up, we got two Microsoft Studios announced titles. You get Drive Club. I really want to see the segment on The Order.
That is the second time I've seen that, and the first one, I literally like just flew back in my seat while I was sitting down watching it. It's so emotional.
Good. Here was another moment that was pretty special.
Oh, man.
In a weird way. Yeah, we're really looking to try and drive something pretty cool.
I don't know why, but that game, like, really has me for some reason. I don't know. I mean, it looks good, but there's just for some reason something more to it for me, and that's why I'm so curious about it. Is what about that game has me so captivated? Is it the setting along with like the steampunk technology, you know, because it's like, you know, old London, but they got freaking walkie talkies on them, you know, they're using candle powered lanterns for crying out loud, they have walkie talkies. Maybe it's the mix. The Order 1886. What did I say before? 66? Like that game just really has my interest. Like I've already looked up collector's editions, and I don't do that. I really don't. I don't do collector's editions just because of all the money. I mean, and you just get, you know, some little memorabilia for it's a little statue or a book or something like that. But yeah, it's just insane. You made the wrong order. Or maybe just the right order. Who knows? Yeah, I mean, as far as gameplay, we've only seen, what, one trailer of it? Or unless that was like some cinematic, they give you some control kind of ability. Which, that might be what we really saw, instead of actual gameplay. Let me look here. Batman just looks, oh my gosh, Batman just, I gotta play through the Arkham series before that comes out. And I have to have a PS4 on that day. No question about it. Batman just looks amazing. You know what? The one thing I really liked about the Batmobile, I loved about the Batmobile, is they incorporated the look of the original Tim Burton's Batmobile from the Michael Keaton film back in the 1980s. That was like one of my favorite Batmobiles of all time. So now it's like they took that one, combined it with the technology of the recent trilogy into just one beautiful object of just destruction. Shooters, I haven't played a lot of story-driven shooters, I like to say. I never looked at Call of Duty as a story-driven shooter. I just looked at it as war. Bioshock. I loved Bioshock. 2 was meh. But 1, and then 3, and then the DLC of 3. That story. Oh, that story. The Order, though. Oh, God. I gotta get to the bottom of why I have that. The strafing, yeah, like the tank mode? That was amazing. That was good. Oh, beautiful stuff. Beautiful stuff. I love the design of the bat suit too. That was pretty cool, actually. Like cable tight. But you could still, it had all the moving pads. Never played the last Bioshock? Oh my god. Bioshock Infinite. And the DLC. I loved it. Absolutely loved it. Absolutely recommend it.
Space wizard, conjure up a piece of the sun, throw it down at its enemies, you know, just sort of gliding through the air on a cloud of light. Very different personalities for every fighting style, but they're all really good contributions to a new explosive sandbox.
Awesome. I can't wait to play the competitive. I did get a chance to dip my toe into the alpha. There's a lot to explore.
Yeah.
And speaking of explore, that's actually one of the things that really grabbed my attention. There's this mode, there's this concept of exploration in Destiny, and there's this sort of big open sandbox with seamless matchmaking. You're finding other players coming in. And I think it was PlayStation fans particularly are going to recognize sort of an element of this from Journey, which is this fan favorite title that had a similar sort of seamless weave in, weave out co-op. Tell me a little bit about Explore. I think it's so fascinating.
Yeah, it's something that you don't see a lot in a first-person shooter, a first-person action game like the ones that Bungie have been known for over the years. So we're taking the heart-pounding action that we always love to pack into our games, but we're opening it up a little bit. So instead of a campaign mission where you jump from waypoint to waypoint, you can literally just get out there in the open, and there are going to be aliens and hostile combatants in different locations in old Russia. So we've opened the entire destination to you. You can go there, set down in the landing zone. At the same time, as you go through and you fight these enemies to collect rewards, things that you can trade back in the tower for upgrades to your character, you're going to encounter other guardians. They may be a guardian who is on a story mission. They can be on their way to, you know, the first phase of a strike. They could be doing any number of things on their own adventures. And where your adventure meets theirs at a crossroads, there are these public spaces. And that's where crazy things can happen. You know, fallen capital ships can spawn into the atmosphere and overfly you. You know, dropping off drop ships, and they start mining minerals from the planet. Really, the sort of thing that we were demonstrating last year on this stage when we were doing the worldwide gameplay reveal. Only now it's a thing that you can play. We're inviting you in. It's not about watching, it's about you really understanding what it's like to play this thing.
Good stuff. I mean, I sort of canvassed this area in old Russia in exploration.
Yeah.
Or explore. And I was, I thought I had sort of combed every nook and cranny, and then I realized, hey, there's this whole, like, interstellar graveyard of fallen ships and airplanes. And, stuff.
Yeah.
And it was this gigantic other area of the game. I mean, the game seems just so dynamic. Seems like there's a lot of nooks and crannies.
Well, the landscape tells a story of its own. You know, old Russia is a place where humanity was building huge colony ships to rush out to the stars when we were colonizing our solar system. That obviously didn't go too well for us, given the post-apocalyptic nature of the story, you know, the narrative of Destiny. But as Guardians, we are looking to reclaim everything.
Yeah, right now I'm just flipping between PlayStation's cast and E3. They're just still talking about Call of Duty.
Of heroes, and I can tell tell you, I still get lost in old Russia. You know, some of the game designers who spend more time playing the game than I do, you know, when I'm not head down over Facebook or Twitter, still get lost in old Russia or discover new things that they had yet to find. You know, like some boss that's just secreted away in a cave somewhere who you're not going to have the strength to kill in the alpha. You're going to have to come back later after you've completed activities, some other strikes or missions that we're holding back for the final version of the game. So like I said, the alpha really is sort of your first step into the world of Destiny. We'll give you a beginning experience as to what it's like to build a character, but there's only so much you can level up because we don't want this to spoil anyone's experience in playing the beta or, of course, the final release of the game in September.
Awesome. So that alpha is going to kick off this Thursday on PS4. If you've got a PS4, you can head to greatnessawaits.com/destiny, register for a chance to get in. I want to zero in a little bit, though, on something else that Destiny offers, and you'll get a taste of it in the alpha. Is this, there's just loot, there's equipment, there's weapons. It's not just sort of this static guns of the game. There is a vast arsenal.
And we're giving you, again, a sampling of that vast arsenal.
I mean, Destiny is looking pretty interesting, though.
Side missions and gaining favor with them so that they'll unlock different portions of their product line to you. So the weapons that you carry, the gear that you wear, will indicate the allegiances that you've sworn to different political factions in the universe. It'll indicate which activities that you've taken a shine to. So you'll be able to look at somebody and say, this guy has played the strikes on every level of difficulty. He's got strike.
And they've finally shut up about Call of Duty. Yay. Sorry, just Call of Duty. If you're a fan of it, I apologize if you're offended. I'm just not a Call of Duty guy anymore. I used to be, like, years ago. I loved, well, yeah, last one I played was Black Ops. And,
So, Destiny Alpha, it's going to be out on Thursday on PS4. Go to greatnessawaits.com/destiny, register for a chance to get in. That is it for us on Destiny. Stay tuned. We're going to have Battlefield Hardline coming up next.
Oh man. Uncompromising commitment to gamers that ensures PlayStation is above all else the best place to play. Look at that. That is so sexy looking. To its deeply immersive gameplay, Destiny will help define this next generation of gaming. I'm happy to announce our first ever white PlayStation 4 with an exclusive Destiny bundle. That will make available when the game releases on September. Oh yeah, don't forget you can get that white PS4. Get your hands on Entwine. The PS4 version is available right now in the PlayStation Store. Have they shown anything about Far Cry? Yeah, they've covered Far Cry 4 a couple of times now. DLC that will be available later this summer. What is this? Oh, Infamous First Light. Little Big Planet. I get the honor of introducing a completely new IP. Welcome to the world of Bloodborne.
Our goal with Far Cry is to create beautiful, exotic, and dangerous locations, fill them with weapons, vehicles, and toys, and let you create your own story.
What did they say what the content was for the pre-order? I haven't looked that up yet. Invite your PSN friends to join you, even if they don't own the game. And you'll only be able to do that on PlayStation. After 15 years, Double Fine, in tandem with our third-party production team, will be remastering your classic adventure game, Grim Fandango. It looks like there's a few small clips of some more gameplay for The Order 1886 on YouTube. I'll have to watch those in a little bit. But Mom! Alright, so what, Alright, what's going on at E3 here? Oh! Racing games! Yeah. Everyone take a nap. I love racing games. Then this shit is right up your alley, sir. I will say the last racing game I played probably the hell out of it was Need for Speed Underground. I can't decide who did better. Funny Nintendo. I'll say for presentation, definitely Nintendo. Definitely Nintendo. PlayStation talked way too much. Way too much. With the PlayStation, you know, TV and everything like that. When they saw the robot chicken. Yeah, that was a bit surprising, actually. I was surprised that they actually tied robot chicken in with it. Yeah, oh my god, the opening fight. Those moves, man, they were throwing down. They were throwing the fuck down. Oh my god, he literally was putting me to sleep. I was sitting here this morning watching and I was like, wow, man. I know you're coming out with all this amazing stuff for the PlayStation, blah, blah, blah. Just highlight, give us the highlights and just move forward. Literally, I kid you not. I was literally falling asleep. It was so bad. I was so happy when he stopped talking and continued on. See, there you go, Crusader. You have a real life tie with it. Yeah, that would be natural. Yeah, although, let me look up something here. It's what a few people have been saying is that the Star Fox is only a mini game.
driving cars even. So because it's a cloud-based system,
that's right. What we're trying to do is create an
all-new
fantasy within the Battlefield universe.
Put them directly into Horizon. So
you
drive a car. You play Forza 5.
Whether you start with 1942 to Vietnam, 2142 to the present day, it's something that they've always done.
It's an open-world game.
We were excited to bring cops and criminals flavor.
So right now we're in a cliff area, so you can't really go right over this edge. But there's huge swaths of this massive world where you can just drive wherever you want. And that means there can be barn finds and hidden things, like any open world game, all over the place. Well, if you follow your friend's drive avatar, he's found
one of
those secrets. His
drive avatar, even if
it's not your friend, they're not online, will lead you to these secrets.
Such good balance.
And that just
kind
of happens naturally. Again, a lot of
the
stuff, traditionally, you
prize. It's the original Star Fox remastered. Although I would play the hell out of that. To be completely honest with you, I would play the original Star Fox remastered. That animation, though, they had before that presentation. I was sitting there thinking, I was like, are they coming out with like a Super Smash Brothers movie? Anime? Because, yeah, they had that Ratchet and Clank. And then it turns out to be a movie. It's like the con. Yeah. Yeah.
So one of them is asymmetrical. The heist is basically a mode where the criminals are trying to get away with a big bag of loot and the cops are trying to stop them. So both sides are doing different things. So
well, I'm definitely going to buy a Wii U just if anything at all, it's going to be for the Zelda. That looked amazing. Which I need to play Skyward Sword. I really like Twilight Princess, and I don't know. Maybe I'm afraid that Skyward Sword's not going to be there. Don't look at the character design. Just look at the giant robots. That's all I was looking at. Fucking huge mechs. Doesn't mean they have any advantage over the potatoes. I know I've brought it up before, but has anyone here played Xenogears? Oh, see, if you bet your ass, we're going to have some golf here on SHP. We're going to have some golf. I want to sink some battleships like a birdie. I want to get a birdie on a battleship. If I get a hole in one, I'll poop myself. Well, what they announced for the 3DS, Pokemon and God, it was a couple of other things.
So we've got our map High Tension, we've got Blood Money and Heist. So those are up there right now.
Very cool. And what are we looking at for the final release date?
Xeno Gears, what?
We're looking at October 21st here in North America for the release date. And by the way, if anybody wants to get a code for the beta, I'm actually giving giving a bunch away today and throughout E3 on my Twitter account, which is @uptime. So if you follow me, I'll ask a weird question.
I mean, that's just a weird thing. I don't know what they were thinking with that. The battleship is on fire, running aground. And you gotta, like, hit your ball over it. What's PlayStation cover now? Battlefield. Or Battlefield. Alright. There's... That's what. So we got Lords of the Fallen coming up in like what, an hour almost? A little over an hour. We got more Destiny. We got the Order. Call of Duty Golf. I love it. Oh, Kingdom Hearts. There's the 1.5 remix. I need to play Kingdom Hearts. Yeah, I've never played a Kingdom Hearts. T-Dot Crook, what's going on? Welcome to the cast. Well, I'm definitely slowly putting together a schedule here. Long-term schedule at that of a lot of games that we gotta get through here. Oh my god. So yeah, what we gotta get through here? We gotta get through both Witchers, both Dragon Ages, the Arkham series. What's going on, the Martin? Here's Bloodborne. Yeah, so they... What has anyone heard what the deal is with Project Beast? Anyone? What the hell? Bloodborne is pro- Well, apparently I'm a little behind the times here. So hot damn. Okay. Well, shit. Fuck me then. Station cover order. Cover next. Oh no. God, I want to see that art. Oh my god, that Batmobile. Oh my god, that's. Oh, I look at it and my eyes just have an organ. That's going to be so beautiful. Ubisoft. Oh my god, dude. So many people are going to get all of my money in the near and distant future. Oh my god. It's going to be terrible. Disappointed by the Nintendo conference? I think they present themselves pretty well, really. What is this? All puppies love to be pampered. Oh, it's Nintendogs, but for Sony. Good. I've wanted one of these. This is what we've been waiting for. I've been waiting for Nintendogs, but for PlayStation. Except dogs can talk and you dress them up and do things with them, like play mini games. Oh my god. We are so casting the fuck out of this here. If you're watching the PlayStation cast right now. And they are covering Halo. Okay. And more handheld. Oh, the Borderlands handheld?